Very good. So the talk tonight is going to be about machine learning on .NET, and specifically subtitle F# for the win. So it's like my big interest is F# and functional programming, and so I'm going to be talking about these two topics. So maybe on top of the introduction, like the things you might or might not want to know is that, so my name is Matthias. You can find me, the best way to reach me is probably on Twitter at Brandewinder. Otherwise, I look usually like that guy on the right on GitHub, on Twitter, all these places. Like if you see that, that's probably me. I'm actually not a software engineer. Or I am now, but like this is the one thing I'm fully unqualified in. So my background is actually in economics and operations research. So economics, I was particularly interested in forecasting models, econometrics and decision theory, and operations research. Most people don't really know what it is, but essentially it's applied math focused on optimization. And so 10 years ago, completely by accident, I was doing a lot of horrible things, in particular VBA and Excel development, and I realized that it was probably not great, and so I started to look for better tools. I started playing with .NET, started developing with C#, and that was what I did for a long time. And then 4 or 5 years ago, a friend of mine told me, hey, you should learn a new language every year. And so I thought, that sounds like a good idea. Opened the box, looked at F# because it looked different, and I just started playing with it. And since then, I have completely fallen in love with the language, and so that's my primary language at that point. Otherwise, user group, I'm very involved with user groups and all this. As somebody pointed out, in case you didn't pick it up yet, I do have a bit of an accent, tiny bit. And the reason I'm mentioning this, so first, yeah, it's a French accent in case it's not obvious. And the reason I'm mentioning this is not necessarily because the accent is important, but it's more because the accent might make me complicated to understand. Like, so first thing, I might be hard to understand. Second thing is that I do have a tendency to get excited about topics I care about. And usually what happens is I speak faster and faster. As a result, I might become very hard to understand. So if that's the case, it's your job to stop me, to tell me, hey, slow down. Is that a deal? Okay. And that's it. Yeah, otherwise that's all I have to say about me. So just out of curiosity, I don't really know who's in the room. I know some people, I don't know the others. So out of curiosity, who has written F#, say, in the past year? Okay. Who has written some .NET or C# code in the past year? Okay. So who has used other functional languages? Maybe, okay, like, so I'm going to ask what? Like, okay, oh, awesome. So that's not too far. Oh, that's great. We need to talk afterwards. Anybody maybe from Haskell, from Scala, from Clojure, from anything, from Lisp? From, so a bit of everything. So a bit of everything. Okay, that's cool. And anybody who's coming from, who's a data scientist, a machine learning person, or something like that? Okay, so this is interesting. So essentially in the room, I have like a bit of .NET people, a bit of F# people, a bit of functional people, a bit of machine learning people, and not everybody raised their hands, so there is also a complement, which is neither of these. So this is what makes this talk a bit tricky, because like I need to talk about functional, about F#, about machine learning, so it's going to be difficult to serve everybody completely. So I'm going to try my best. So why I wanted to do this talk, or where this talk is coming from, is like the first. This is probably particularly obvious in the Bay Area and in San Francisco, but like machine learning and data science are super hot topics right now. So I'm a data scientist, so I brought some data with me, and so I just pulled like some, these are like actual meetings from last year on machine learning and data science meetups in San Francisco, and all of them have like 200, 300 registration lists. Like it's just like, it's a super hot topic. One thing which I find interesting and which is a bit sad maybe, is like lots of people, lots of software engineers think that machine learning is something for statisticians who are doing statistics. And I think that's one thing I hope to dissipate a bit today, is that machine learning, the reason it's called machine learning and not statistics is because part of it is about numeric algorithms and about statistics, but part of it is also about having code running in production. So if you're a computer science guy, you like algorithms, you like distributed computation, all these things, this is a super exciting area to dive in. So I would recommend, like, the message here is like, don't shy away if you're a software engineer, like you should definitely look into it, at least like take a look at it because it's fun. And the other point for me is like, so most of the time I spent in the past 10 years has been in .NET. And so if I look at most of the meetups, I'm going to hear lots of things like Python, like R, maybe Scala with the Spark and things like that. And it's like people don't really talk a lot about .NET. And so that's something which saddens me, because I think actually, I would think that C# is not the best tool for the job, but I think F# actually has a lot to offer on that particular domain. And so that's why I want to talk about it, to say, hey, like, look, F# is there and it's pretty awesome. So my goal today with this talk will be, as I said, I can't do in 1 hour a full exposition on machine learning. I can't do a full exposition on F#. So what I'm going to try to do is, like, I'm going to assume you're not a machine learning expert, and I'm going to try to give you a sense of what machine learning is about. And the second side is, like, I'm going to try to explain why I think F# is a great fit and expose maybe some ideas about F# in general. That's kind of my goal. And then if you have questions, if you want to take it in different directions, we can adapt a bit. I won't be spending that much time with slides. I will be spending most of my time actually doing maybe live coding or showing some things. So don't freak out. All the code, all the samples are... Should I speak closer to this?
You're fine.
Okay, yeah, plus I move a lot, so that's a little bit complicated. So all the code, all the samples on GitHub, you can find it under my name, under presentations. I can even put it on the comments for the meetup afterwards if you want to dive in. So the point is, like, it's there, you can dive in afterwards if you want to. So the plan I'm going to follow is roughly in 4 parts, with the 2 parallel tracks. So I said I wanted to talk a bit about maybe .NET and F# and a bit about machine learning. So the first, we're going to talk about classification and regression. And at the same time, I'm going to talk on the .NET side about what libraries you have available in .NET to use for machine learning, and talk about algebra with regression. Then I'm going to talk a bit about what unsupervised learning is about. And I'm going to tie it with why I think functional languages are actually a very good fit for machine learning algorithms. And then I'm going to finish with something which is called type writers, which is really which ties with both, and which is just like awesome. If you have not seen a type writer before, it's just awesome. So that's the plan. I figured also, and that it looks like it was a safe assumption, that the room would not be necessarily familiar with F#. So I figured it would be a good idea to give you in one slide like what you probably need to know about F#. So the first thing is, like, F# is a functional first language. So maybe it's not Scala, but it's in the same line of thought as Scala. It's a functional language which does also object if you want to, runs and it's statically typed. So that's it's in the train. Technically, it's a dialect of ML and OCaml. So that's where it's coming from. The other thing you probably want to know is, like, people when they hear .NET tend to think .NET is just Windows and I won't touch it. So F# is cross-platform, meaning, like, it runs like on Windows, obviously, but it runs also on Linux, it runs on OS X. It works obviously with Visual Studio, but it works with Xamarin Studio. I know people who do work with it using Emacs. There is tons of work with Atom, so it's like it's working pretty much everywhere. It's also battle tested, like, it's not an experimental language. It has been in production since 4 or 5 years. Like, for instance, Jack was here, he's working in a company called Tuckers, and they're running their operations on F# since a couple of years. So it's not like something which kind of works, like, it works. Originally created by Microsoft Research, the compiler has been on GitHub since a while and is actually completely on GitHub. So it's entirely open source at that point, meaning, like, the work is in the open, they take contributions from the outside, and in general, the language and the community is extremely open source driven and extremely community driven. So this is, in one slide, what I want to say about F#, and then if you have more questions, we can talk about that. So now I'm going to dive in the topic of machine learning with F#. And so the first topic I wanted to talk about was classification and regression. And so my goal in this small stretch will be to maybe give you a sense of what does a machine learning person do, maybe at a slightly, how to put it, like, I'll give you a sense for, if you do machine learning, what are you doing and how does your day look and how is it different from a software engineer? And I'm going to illustrate 2 techniques, or like 2 completely different directions in machine learning, which I call classification and regression. So this is more the primer on machine learning, but terms you're going to see around terms of classification and regression are like a division in machine learning. So when you're building a classification model, what you're trying to do is you're trying to build a model which is going to classify items. The prototypical example is probably a spam recognizer. Like if I give you an email and you're trying to put it, is this spam or is this not spam, that's a classifier. I'm trying to put things in buckets. If I'm doing character recognition, that's probably a classification problem. On the other end of the spectrum, you have something which is called regression. Regression is different from classification in that in regression, you're actually trying to predict a number. For instance, I'm trying to predict for how much you're going to sell that car, given that it's 10 years old and that the engine is that big and that this and that. And so here, I don't really have buckets. The output is one number and my model could predict any number. So this is a division, if you are looking to machine learning, you're going to see classification and regression problems, and they are just like a big division. Also, both of these, I put them in the same bucket here, and the bucket is called supervised learning. I'm going to talk afterwards a bit about unsupervised, but supervised model is, I know the question I'm trying to answer. For instance, in the case of a spam recognizer, I know that I have a question, is that what I want to do is I want to recognize whether it's spam or ham. So in that case, I know the question and what I have is a data set where I have the answers to the question and I'm trying to find the best possible model to give me an answer to that question I'm after. And the opposition to this, which we'll see later, is like unsupervised, and in unsupervised, I have data, I don't even know what my question is, and the question is like, hey, can you tell me something about my data? So that's just, yes? It pulls from, in general, machine learning is a really broad area which pulls from different places. Like spam and ham is going to draw probably on some natural language processing. So some of it is coming from regression models. Some of it is coming from operations research. So it's really, lots of things are converging. Like when somebody tells you I'm a data scientist or I'm a machine learning person, it's like, if I told you I'm a software engineer, it's like I have only a very vague idea of what you do. Like, and so what we're going to do is I'm going to look at a problem of classification and I'm going to use an algorithm which is called the support vector machine, and so how it works exactly is not very important. But in the idea of the algorithm is I have two groups I want to classify, black or white, and what the model is going to do is look at the data and try to find the widest possible way to separate between the two cases, to a model which finds the biggest boundary between them. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to use a library on .NET, which is called accord.NET. And I'm going to start diving in. So at that point, is like this is, of course, my thing doesn't work. I'm going to go to my development environment. I'm assuming everybody can read. I checked before, because like, it's big enough for everyone. So here, I'm in Visual Studio. Like you could run it also on Xamarin or whatever you want. Like it just happens that I have this machine with this installed. And so I'm going to take a classic classification problem, and that's using the minced dataset, which is okay. So and before that, okay. So sorry. I'm going to backtrack a bit because my assumption was that people might have never seen F-sharp before, so I thought like before completely diving in into F-sharp, I will maybe show you a tiny bit of code, which is somewhat relevant to what I'm going to be doing, but just to show you a bit, like give you a sense for what F-sharp is and maybe how it might differ from the language you're using. So the first thing I'm going to do here is I'm actually going to go to F-sharp has built in a scripting environment. So if you come from Python, you would probably say, hey, big deal, of course, it has what language doesn't have a scripting environment? If you come from other languages, like I came from C#, I was never using a REPL before, but so it's like the REPL is built in, and I can use that scripting environment right here. So here, I'm going to be working with my script. And the first thing I will want to do, so the data set I'm going to work on is like your typical data file. So this is actually typically how your day as a machine learning person starts, is like you're going to get a file which probably looks a bit like that. Maybe it's a bit bigger, a bit worse, but like you have like a ton of data and you're trying to make some sense out of this. So this particular data set is the minced data set. And the minced data set is like, the goal is to recognize digits which have been written by humans. So these are actually scans where like people just wrote a 1, a 7, a 4, a 9 on a piece of paper. They asked this, I think there are like 50,000 examples of this, and they are scanned, and your goal is like from this to recognize the images. So that's what I'm going to demo here. And as a first step, I figured, so the data set I have here is like, I think 5,000 images, where I have like, this is a 1, this is a 0, this is a 1, this is a 4, and then I have like something like 800 pixels as a flat line. So that's the data set I have. Yes?
This is, it
could be stored as a sparse metric. It happens to be stored as just a good old dirty flat file, like entry for everything. And so I'm just going to, before diving into the machine learning side, I figured like it would be interesting to take a small problem and show you like how I would use F# to do that and maybe introduce some basic concepts. And so my first problem with this is like, that's great, I have a text file. What I want is I want to read it in memory in something which is probably label, which is like what is the number, and then pixels, which are like integers from 0 to 255. So how would I do that? I'm going to go back to my file here, and like the first thing I can do is I can actually use anything which is in .NET. So for instance, I can do something like let data equal, and here I'm going to do file dot read all lines. And so this is where having a statically typed language is very convenient, because like I'm getting lots of help, the compiler is there with me. And here I'm going to pass it the address of my training set. And so the thing, I could use .NET. Then the thing which was nice is like if I look at data here, this is actually, even though I didn't tell it what type is, like it's entirely statically typed using type inference. So it's looking at, hey, you're reading a file using this method, so obviously what you get out is an array of strings. So now we can run this. I'm going to run this in my REPL, and here I go, I have like my file in memory. So that's good. That's good, but that's really not that great. What I have here is an array of strings. What I really want is an array of things I want to break out every line. For instance, take this line, and I want to break it according to the comma, and make it into an array of integers. So how would I do that? The first thing I would do is I would create a function, and so this is where maybe it looks a bit like Python. Let's say I'm going to write a parse function, which is going to take a line, and that line is going to be a string. And so what I could do here is the first thing I could do is I could do let post equal line dot split, so I can still use whatever I have in .NET. And so here you can see a pattern like so this is one of the similarities maybe with Python is like compared to a language like Java, like C#, the syntax is first like it's a white space delimited, and this makes for a very lightweight syntax and like a very short code and in my opinion very readable. So I read this, and now what I have out of this, what I got is a capacity to string, so what I should get is an array of strings. But that's not what I want. What I want is an array of ints. So how would you do that? Here you would use a pattern which you're going to see a lot in functional programming, and that would be I'm going to apply a map. I have like a long array of string, 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 and what I want is I want to transform them into int, 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 int. So what I will do is I will say, hey, take that array, and map it, and the way I'm going to map it is that I want to apply the function int to this thing. So what this is saying is that you're going to take the parsed, which is an array of strings, and going to apply to each element int, and giving back the resulting map. And so as a result, my function now is taking a string and giving back an array of ints. So that's, I realize it's a very heavy crash course on a functional, but I hope this gives you a bit of an idea of what's happening. So if I run this here, I can do that, and so for instance, I can test in my REPL immediately, I should be able to do parse, and I call this data, so I'm going to do data one, and this works. So now it's like I got out of a line of text, I got like an array of things. So the last thing I want to show here, is like in a perfect world, I don't really want to deal with arrays. I would probably want to have something a bit more explicit because, hey, like it's 2015. It's like so what I could do is I could also use things which is something which is called a record. And so here I'm going to create something which is called an example. And an example is going to be two things. It's going to be a label, which is an int, and it's going to be pixels, which is going to be an int array. And so you can think of this as at a very rough approximation, this is a fully done immutable class, like it's there for me, and I can start using it as a container. And so the way I would use this is like, now what I want to do is I really want to take my data set, I want to parse every single line, and I want to move every single line into an example, so that I really get an array of examples. So the way I'm going to do that is fairly simple, I would do it this way. I'm going to introduce something here, it's like let data set.
And so this is where I'm going to take a leap, because I don't want to spend too much time on this one, but I'm going to explain what I'm doing. If you think about it, what I really want to do is I want to apply a pipeline of functions to my original data set. So I'm going to pipeline things. So I'm going to say, hey, take the training set, pipe that data into one function, and that function is to refine the tree all length. And so at that point, it's like the data set should be a string array. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to pipe it to another function, which is lines, and I'm going to drop the headers. So I'm going to slice it. I'm going to say take the lines and just keep one to the last one. And then I have lines, so at that point I should still have like an array of ends, of strings, sorry. Now next step is I'm going to, what I want is I have lines, I want to transform them into by parsing. So I'm going to do array.map. Map parse. So this is saying, hey, you have an array, on each line apply the parse. So this is going to give me an array of ends. And it's like, so now I should have like an array of ends, very good. And the next step here is going to be, that's great, but now I want this to become, an example. So I'm going to do array.map fun of a line. So I'm going to take a line, and here I'm going to create a record. And so that record is going to be, the label is going to be line.0. And the pixels, that's actually correct. Oh, thank you. That's not correct. See, that's again the. Thank you. I did that on purpose to show the power of having a statically typed language, because it's telling me, hey, like, that's not correct. So yeah, thank you. So now it builds, and pixels should be line dot, and that's it. And so now, if I look at this, is like what I should have is like my data set should fully read an array of examples. So I'm just going to run this. And just for the record, like, there are obviously a way better way to parse a CSV file than doing this, but I figured this would be a good example of like how maybe some functional ideas work. So, and here we go, like, I have my data set in memory. And so what I get out of this is like it's statically typed, it's white space delimited, and essentially I create like lots of little functions, and I start pipelining them into bigger and bigger and bigger constructs. That's at a super high level what Hive was. Good. So now I'm going to, any question at that point?
So at the bottom of your code, you have a local decoration site, capital decoration.
Yes, that's a good question. So you're talking about the scope, so the, so I mentioned earlier that F-sharp is coming from ML and OCaml. So it's actually correct in that I can write, I can use the, but OCaml has a bit of a, I hope it's not offensive, but like a bit more of a painful way to write the scope. And so you have to be explicit on like, let x equal 42 n, blah, 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 n. And so F-sharp supports that syntax, but supports a lighter one where I don't need to do that, that declaration. Yes. You're saying that this is not necessarily a good idea.
Well, if you
look at an area, it's very different. Yeah. No, that's correct. I'll talk about this a bit later. Yeah, that's fine. But as long as it fits in memory, if I can make it work that way, it's going to be easier. Yep.
So this example applies a data model of when you have this scanned image, you're sort of mapping it to a matrix that has an assumed implied resolution.
For instance, yep.
Is this way of going from like a real world problem to a data model, are there libraries like where you can learn
Hold that thought. It's like, I'll restate like, I would probably not, like this is not the fastest way to read a CSV file, for instance, there are better ways. Like I just thought it was a good example to show how like you can compose small functions into a pipeline of operations. So
I'm not even focusing on the fact that reading the CSV file, I'm just wondering like translating basically an image to an array of pixels in this manner is just a choice of data model.
Yes.
And I was curious, like maybe you can talk later like about resources, where you can learn about various ways to model real world data that are easily, I guess, you can put them easily to a pipeline.
Yeah, okay, so I'll take also a small step back. Is like I think I have like somewhere between 1 hour and 1 hour and a half, so like if questions pop up. So it's like what I will do is I will reserve the right to say this is a great question, but we'll talk about it afterwards.
Sure.
maybe just a quick shop question here. Which of these lines is pure and which of them is pure?
Here, everything in what I did is pure. Yeah, but I'm reading the file, right? I'm not mutating anything. The code I'm running here is eager, so that's I'm assuming you are a Haskeller, maybe. But I could make it lazy as well. But like that's a big difference with technically with Haskell. Haskell, everything is lazy. F sharp is by default eager, and you can make it lazy if you want. Last question. Yep.
So is data set considered or treated as an array?
Okay. Can you repeat?
Yeah. Is data set treated as an array of instances of the type example?
Yes.
Or you have to cast it?
No, that's it. It's done.
Guys, we appreciate the questions, but I think let's reserve the Q&A for after the talk, if that's okay with you.
I think that's fair. So how about we do this? Is like I will take questions if they are just stuff where like really you don't get what's going on and it's blocking the understanding. And otherwise, if it's question on expanding, is like let's keep them for the end. Works?
Thank you.
Yeah, sorry, I got. I should follow the rules. I was bad. So now I'm going to go to so I'm going to just crack this, and I'm going to actually go to the machine learning bit. So here I have I'm going to start from the same data set here, and essentially I'm going to do the same thing, but I'm going to use my library to predict the model. So first I'm going to load up like my library. So this is all sorts of boring stuff, but this is just loading things. So let's load that in the session, and I'm doing exactly the same thing as what we did before. And to the point of the gentleman who was asking if I was loading everything in memory, yes I am, and in that particular case also made sure that the dataset was not gigantic so that I could actually run it on a tiny machine like this one. Like you might not want to run millions of records locally on your machine because that might just not work. So I'm going to do pretty much the same thing I just described before. So I'm just going to take that dataset, write a read data thing which is taking a path. I'm going to transform it into, if you look at the type signature, like that function is taking a path, sorry, and is giving me back something which is an int array, so that's going to be the label, and a float array, which is like the value of the pixel. So just reading data, nothing super sexy so far. And so now I can apply that function to my training set, which are my 5,000 observations, and if I run that, I'm going to get in memory 5,000 observations, and here we go. Yeah, this is done actually. And just for kicks, to illustrate a bit what we're talking about here, so numbers are nice, but sometimes visualization is a bit better, so I just wrote a quick visualizer. This is just taking like random elements from the data set just to show you like what we're trying to classify. So what I'm trying to do is I have like 5,000 of these guys, like which is like a like written by a human, like some of them are pretty clean, some of them are like much less clean, or like pretty awful. So this is like we're dealing with the real world data here, like with all its messiness, and the goal is like can we build a model which when I give it an image will tell me this is a 0 or this is a 7. That's what I'm after. And so here, let's kill this.
The float is some range between black and white.
Yes, it's a 256, it's a grayscale encoded images, and the reason it's a float is because that's what the library is expecting, so just casted it to float. And so how would I set up a model here? So what I described before is like on a supervised model, what I want is like I have a data set and I want to fit a model to learn as best as possible that model. So in this case, I'm using a support vector machine, and so here I'm just going to set up, I'm going to say, hey, I want to use a kernel support machine, and I'm going to teach it using a sequential minimum optimization. It doesn't really matter what it means technically, but I'm resetting up my learner to learn the data set using a particular algorithm. So this is what I would do. I'm going to pass it like what kernel I want to use. And here, if you see this, I'm configuring all my learning algorithm. That's done. And so now what I can do is like my learner is configured and I can say, hey, now look at the data I gave you. Use the algorithm I just gave you and like learn it. And so I'm going to run it. And so this is going to take a bit of time. Not a huge amount of time, but like now this is what this is doing is like it's looking at 5,000 examples and trying to find the best possible match. And so what I'm getting out of this is like it's telling me it's telling me like, hey, like this, my model is currently giving me 5% error, so that would be like 94% correct, which I think not too bad, so that's nice. And so now, now the question is like, are you done? And the that's one way where machine learning is fairly different from writing a regular code. Because when you write code, it's like usually you write your code because you want to write a feature, and the feature either works or it doesn't work. Here it's a bit of a different problem. It's like what I did is I'm using an algorithm, I give it 5,000 data points, I tell it like learn it the best you can, and it's saying yes, I learned it with 95% correct examples. That's not telling me at all that this will work on different data. Right, it's like it's just from that particular data set. The real question I'm interested in is like, will that model work when I give it new images it has never seen? And so that's a big difference. Like as a software engineer, you would probably use a test harness or a test suite. As a machine learning person, what you would be doing is probably running something which is called cross-validation. And so cross-validation in that case is like I used 5,000 examples for training, I kept on the side 500 examples which have not been used for training, and now I'm going to run it through my model and see how good does the model do on that data set. And that's going to tell me if it's good or bad. So here I'm reading my validation set, and now I'm going to simply run it. So here what I'm doing is I'm going to say, hey, take the validation label on the observation, and for each line, I'm going to look at, I have a label and an observation, and if the label is the same thing as what the support vector machine tells me, then it's a one, and otherwise it's a zero, and if I take the average of this, that's going to tell me the percentage correct in that data set. And so I'm going to run this here, and so now this is giving me 92% correct, so it's still pretty good, but it's not quite as good as before. And so the point here, so first I'm also going to do something, which is I'm going to run this. I'm going to pick like 10 random examples in the data set and let's see what the model does. So this, it looked at this and predicted a 4 out of a 4, which I think is pretty good. 2 out of 2. That's actually nice, because that's starting to be pretty ugly. That model is actually working surprisingly well. So yeah, like showing that it's actually working, and it's actually working on examples which are kind of degenerate, or like it's not a trivial task.
Is the model effectively 960
to 64?
Is that what you call the model?
Yes. Here I'm creating the I'm specifying the learner, and the model is like the is the output of this guy. So the point here was, so I wanted to talk a bit about cross-validation. So here, if you write standard code, it's like you write it, it works, you ship it, and you move on with your life. Here, like I'm at 92%, it's like, why not 93%? Why not 94%? Why not 95%? So one of the curses of machine learning is like, especially if you do like machine learning competitions and things like that, is like you're never quite done. And so you have also to think about how far you go. It's like you're not finished with this model, and you could keep improving and improving. That could also mean going faster, on all these things. One of the things I really like about having a REPL or like a scripting environment is like this is hugely important to me also, because I loaded a data set which was not too big here, that's 5,000 examples, and that took already a couple of seconds to load up. Now if I had, it's not unusual for me to have data sets which are going to take like 2-3 minutes to load. If I do this, if I don't have a REPL or a scripting environment, what's going to happen is like every time I make a change, I will have to recompile, I will have to reload my data and rerun my model to see what happens. If I do that, it means I'm going to spend pretty much all my day just loading data. That's not good, right? Like it would be the same thing if I told you, hey, your build is now going to take 5 minutes. You would not be happy. So this is why a scripting environment is really important and why I really like that type of environment. The other thing which is nice is like this was a script, so this was statically typed. That script, I can pretty much change it into a class or a library and ship it in production in 5 minutes from now. So that's one thing I really like too, is like there is no impedance mismatch. I can work in the scripting environment to explore. I can turn it with very minimal change into a DLL or like code which is compiled, which I can drop in an application which uses whatever you use in .NET. So this is very convenient. Like I can use it from the exploration to production. There is no mismatch. Like this is very practical. Cool. So now I want to move to another topic, which is a bit drier, and that's algebra, because I know everybody loves algebra. So let's go to, and I'm going to talk about algebra and regression. And so the reason I want
Did anybody take the Coursera class on the machine learning? Okay, so like this one, but like, so you would probably agree with me that 99% of the class was, hey, here's what you can do with matrices. Like, so algebra in general is a pretty important topic in machine learning. So I'm going to talk a bit about that because as much as algebra is usually not everybody's best memory from high school, it is an important topic and I wanted to talk about it. So I'm going to use another .NET library, which is called math.NET. And the first thing which is nice is like it's not quite as fluid maybe as MATLAB, but like if I want to work with a matrix, I can actually work with something which looks like a matrix, which is usually not the case where you work with an O language. So in this case, if I want to create a matrix A, I just have to declare it that way, and it's actually fairly close to the way you would write it in MATLAB. So I can just write my matrix, and if I want a vector, I can just do this. And then it's like if I want to do things like crazy things like multiply a vector by a matrix, I just multiply a vector by a matrix and it works. So nothing crazy, but like the good thing here is like if I'm working with algebra formulas, it's hard enough to keep your mind around it. So I would like my code to look as close as possible to the way it looks on the algebra or the math book. And I can do that with F#. I can also do things, so again, depends on which language you're coming from, but like if you come from Python, of course, you would expect slicing, but I can also use slicing everywhere. So in this case, I have a vector and I have a matrix. I can very easily say, hey, take that vector and take only column 1 and 2, drop the first one. And I can take my matrix and say, take column 1, 2, and so essentially drop one column and drop one row, and that will just work. And let me actually show the result of that game. So the short version is here is like it's pretty convenient to it's not MATLAB because MATLAB is done explicitly just for algebra, but it's probably as close as you can get outside of MATLAB. Good. So the two reasons really people care about algebra, three maybe, some people just like algebra for itself, that exists too, but like one of the reasons is lots of problems can actually be written in a very compact form and very effective form using algebra. For instance, if I take a regression problem, the simplest model you could do, which is a linear regression, like if you're trying to fit a straight line through a set of points, that formula can be stated as a one-liner in algebra, and that would be like take x, which is your data, transpose, multiply by x, inverse, transpose, and multiply by y, which is the output. That's in one line a complete functional, like a functioning regression model. That's nice, right? Like it's like zero code, like very compact. And so I'm going to just implement that model. I'll show you like how it would look. Here I'm going to create a completely artificial model. I'm going to say, hey, I will have like 500 features I can observe, and I'm going to create 5,000 observations, and I'm going to create a model which is going to be filled with random data, but where I'm going to specify exactly what the model is. So here what I'm saying is like I'm creating I'm going to run it because I don't think it's even worth that I explain it that much. Essentially, I'm creating a fake data set which is just fitting, which is creating a perfect line through data with a random parameters. Good, so I did that. I'm also going to run something which is neat, which is the F# timer. So it's like I can also run this in my code. And so if you recall, my formula was x transpose times x inverse times x transpose times y. My model is going to be as simple as this, so that's pretty much exactly the same as what I had before, and I'm going to run it. So now this is cranking through like 5,500 matrix and trying to find the best possible fit, and it took close to 4 seconds to find the answer to this. The nice thing about the timer, so it gives me like information like, hey, here's how much garbage collection you saw, here's how much time was spent in this, so this is extremely useful if you want to tune your code. So now the question would be, is that model correct? And so I'll ask you to trust me in general, but like I created the true value, which was true beta. Beta is what my model tells me. I'm going to take this value one by one and do the difference. So like if all of it is zero, then it's like a perfect model. And the answer is yes, it's zero. So like that model also works. Good. So nice. Now there is a second reason why people care about algebra. And the reason, so this is where like I have to thank the gamers and all of this, because like besides machine learning people, there's another category of people who really cares about algebra, and that's people who do 3D games. And the reason is, if you think about it, like all of it is about polygons, animating polygons, and so for these guys it's very important to be effective and fast. And so as a result, it's like lots of libraries or lots of work
has been put into actually moving into being very effective about this and potentially moving into the hardware level. And so in this case, what I'm going to show you is how I can use exactly the same model I had. So if you remember, it took me like 4 seconds to run that model. And the only thing I'm going to do is like instead of running that model in the CPU the way I'm doing now, is I'm actually going to target MKL, which is a specialized library written by Intel, which is actually embedded on your CPU, and which is highly optimized just for algebra. And so the way it will work is super simple. I'm going to say, hey, instead of using the standard code, talk to MKL, 3 lines. And so now I'm going to do that, and instead of the same operation as before, and now it's like you might have noticed a slight difference in speed, is like instead of taking 4 seconds, I went down to 0.2 seconds. So like with zero effort, just by calling the hardware, I got like more than 10 times speed up in my computation. So that's one of the reasons people also care about algebra. You could actually go a bit further. So first, like that part is not specific to F#. You can actually totally do it in C#. It's just the syntax is going to be much nicer in F#. The other point about this is like I mentioned the fact that F# was coming from ML and OCaml on this, and ML is about meta language and was primarily developed to do compilers or like code analysis. As a result, is like you have lots of things which are fun with F#, like you have compilers to anything. So every language has today, like if you don't have a compiler to JavaScript, it's like your language is really behind. So of course there are a couple of F# to JavaScript things which exist, but one thing which is particularly interesting for machine learning people is that there is a F# compiler from F# to CUDA. And so that's pretty neat, because I can write high-level code in F#. You have to know a bit of CUDA, like this is not completely my world, so it takes a bit of, it's not quite as easy as the MKL one, but you can write F# code and run it against your CUDA card for big parallelism and huge speedups. There is an effort which I don't know that much about, but which is doing the same thing for, I think, OpenCL, which is another hardware GPU-related thing. So if you are into GPU computing, you should probably look into F# because it's pretty interesting, like you can do pretty nifty things. And I think that will close what I have on regression. Any burning questions, which is like stopping you from, no, it looks like no questions, so I will move forward. So I'm going to go back to my slides for a second. So the takeaway for me from this first part were a few points. First thing which actually I have not talked that much about is like F# is a first-class citizen in .NET. Is like what this means is like I can use any library which was ever written in C# in VB.NET, I can completely use it. Conversely, whatever code I write in F#, other people can use it as well. Like it's not, you're not using a language which works with nothing else, like it comes in a large ecosystem and you can use everything which happened there. The second point I wanted to make, which I probably went fast on, was people like Python because there is a big ecosystem like scikit, for instance, or like R has these packages. .NET probably doesn't have quite the same depth as scikit, but there is a lot of very good libraries. Like Accord.NET is actually surprisingly good. Like you have support vector machines, you have logistic, you have neural networks, you have like a gazillion of things which are there and which exist as well. Math.NET is great for algebra. Alia.Cubase is the thing I was mentioning about CUDA. So there is actually there are tools which are really awesome. The interactive experience with this, with the REPL, like with the scripting environment, is for me as a data science guy like very important. And otherwise, I hope I give you a bit of a sense of what classification was, regression was, and cross-validation was. So now, I want to move to the other area I mentioned earlier, which was unsupervised learning. So what I will do is I will illustrate in one example what unsupervised learning is, and what I'm going to try to do is to maybe give you a high-level sense for why I think functional programming with machine learning are actually a good fit. And that it doesn't matter if it's F#. Like for me, the point works with Lisp, the point works with Scala, but like in general, I find it's just a really, really good fit. One of the points here is in lots of cases I will end up, so you would say that if you have libraries, like why would you even care? But like I end up like writing lots of my code in machine learning. Like in general, if a developer tells me, hey, I'm going to write my library, I would say like that's great, but look first for what's available. But it actually happens quite, it happens more often than not with machine learning, because first you don't always have the library you want. And then the other one is like, I find that, because actually lots of the things you will use in machine learning is surprisingly young compared to software, like lots of the ideas you use in software are like 40 years old. In machine learning, it's not unusual to have people actually working on a research paper from last year. So then it's like, if it's last year, you probably don't have a library. So it's like, hey, like, either you implement it or like you can't use it. The second one is like, I find it's actually useful to write your own, because libraries are great, except that they force you to transform all your domain to fit with the way the library thinks about the world. And so sometimes like writing your own code is actually pretty helpful, because you can integrate very closely with the rest of your domain and all of this. So for all these reasons, like, the short point here is like, it's not unusual to write your own libraries, or like I write my own code quite often. Maybe that's also just because I like to do it, but that's what I do. So, and then if you do that, is like you might notice a bit of a pattern on how your algorithms are going to look. Like pretty much every time I write an algorithm, first, like your problem is going to look along these lines. I have data, I need to read it. Then if I take the data, I read it, and now I'm going to transform it into features. That might be putting into a matrix, that might be putting it into another data structure, but I'm trying to take it and move it into a different representation. Then, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take these features and give it a learner, which is going to try to find the best possible fit for the problem I have at hand. And finally, I'm going to test that model by evaluating how good it is against validation data. That's kind of like how my process looks for pretty much everything in machine learning. And now if you do that, out of these four steps, like they map really well with a functional stack. Read data, I will talk about it a bit later, like we have a magic trick in F-sharp with the tag provider. Transform into features, like this is a bit what I showed in the introduction. That's what you call a map typically in a functional language. It's like I'm going to have observations and I'm going to map every single observation to a different model. Like it just fits like to a T. The next one is like I have objects and I have a target I'm trying to optimize against. Typically what I'm going to do is I'm going to use recursion here. Is like I have a model, I tweak a bit the input. Is it better? Keep going and keep improving and improving until it's done. That's recursion is also a core pattern of functional style. And finally, now that I have a model, is that what I'm going to do is I'm going to run it against a validation set and produce an output which is going to tell me how good or how bad it is. That's an aggregate, and that aggregate would be produced typically by a fold or a reduce. So all these things is just like tack, tack, tack. Like it's like you take your introduction to functional programming and it just like fits to a T. Like it just happens all the time. Yes.
So featured in the example that you used the first time with the number recognizer.
Yep.
Is the float, the fact that you chose to represent that range as a float, considered?
It's a good question. So, in general, like feature would be like what is the measurement about my observation, which I think is useful for my model. In this particular case, the features where I'm going to represent my input as an array of integers, which are each of my pixels. And that could be more complicated, less complicated. So that really depends on the problem at hand. So I'm going to try to show this a bit on an unsupervised learning example. So I mentioned earlier that unsupervised, what you're trying to do here is that really somebody comes to you and say, hey, I have data, I don't even know what I'm looking for, tell me something about my data. Can you find structure? Can you tell me something I didn't know about it? So the prime example for this would be clustering. And clustering, the example would be here is like 10 years of customer data. Can you tell me if some people behave a certain way, and if I have actually a group of people which behave in a similar manner? That's what you're after with clustering. So the textbook algorithm, or like the most classic base for clustering, is an algorithm called k-means. And so in this case, like suppose that my data looks like this. This is my customers. This is whatever you want, and I have two groups. So the first thing I can do is I'm going to assume I have two clusters, and I'm going to create centroids. So centroids are these big things in the side, and the first step of my algorithm will be take my data set and take every point and assign it to the closest centroid. So for instance, the blue guys on the right will be assigned to the centroid in the middle, and the other ones are all with the same centroid. I think it's red. It's like I'm colorblind, so I never quite know what the color is. But like you get the idea. Like I'm assigning each element to the closest centroid. Next step of the algorithm is like now that I assigned everything, I have clusters. Like I have a red cluster and a blue cluster. Now is like if my centroid, which is my prototypical representation for the cluster, is good, it should be lying somewhere in the middle of my cluster. And so the update would be take everybody in the cluster and move the centroid to the middle of the of the cluster. And next step would be, hey, like repeat, rinse and repeat until like nothing changes. Like in that case, if I repeat the operation, the cluster will be the same, so I have nothing to change, so I'm done and my clusters are finished. So that's kind of what the, how the algorithm works. So I'm going to show you a bit this in application in a practical, on an actual example. So let me go to the clustering bit here. And so here I'm also going for like a super classic data set, which is so the Iris data set. It's like it's definitely not big data. It's not even small data. I think they're like 40 elements. Oh no, actually, okay, it's not tiny data. So what this is like 100 observations from irises, which are flowers. And what this is like it's giving you like the sepal length and the sepal width, whatever that means. Like I really don't know. Like a measurement on the flower and the petal length and the petal width, and then a class which is like different types of irises. So I have Iris setosa, I have Iris versicolor, and Iris virginica. So in short, what I have is like I have three types of flowers with four measurements, four different measurements about them. And I'm going to assume that I actually don't know what the class is, and so I'm going to unleash a clustering algorithm on it, hoping that it will find some clusters. So if I go back here, so this is same as before. I have my data set here. I'm going to read it into an observation, which is going to have like all the data I was talking about, like sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width. So I read my data set in memory. Sorry, I'm going to read my data set here. So now I have my data set. So the first thing I might want to do is like it might be actually useful to visualize a bit what the data set looks like. So one thing I could, for instance, want to do, we need to do a scatter plot. So how would I do that? Is like, I think this was data. So suppose, for instance, that I wanted to take the data for observation in data. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to extract out. So this is again where types are nice. I'm going to, for each observation in my data set, like let's say I'm going to extract out the petal length. And I could extract out something like, I don't know, like the sepal width. And so what I would want is I would want to pass this into a chart. So this is what I'm going to do. Dot point, dot pi. And so if I do this, like what I should see is like this is how my data set looks like. So not super sexy, but like I can start taking my data, looking at it. And this is again like where I like to have types, because I could do something like, hey, how about I want to look at petal width, like is this looking any different? So this is where I really like types, because I'm getting help on what features are available, not available. I can't even make a typo. Like if I have a typo, I can't even run that code. So it helps me also explore my data set. So this is how the data set looks like. Not great, not super exciting, but like I could do something a bit more interesting here. So I'm going to group them actually by class and color it differently for each of the types we have. And so this is what you can see here is like the data set is like you actually have kind of clusters based on the features. Like this was I think petal width and the other one, and you can see like three groups. So if I'm unleashing like a clustering algorithm on this, I would better observe. There is some hope to find clusters. So let's do that. And so the code is available in GitHub, so I'm going to let you look at it in more detail if you want. Like I don't have fully time to go into the implementation, but here I have a full implementation of k-means, like the algorithm I was describing. I think it's, and this is actually probably extra verbose, but like this is like in 60 lines, I have like the full algorithm working. And the one point I want to make, so I was saying like everything, all my algorithm looked the same, as I said there was recursion, is like sure enough, I have a search, and that search is going to search recursively until I have an improvement in my model. I have like maps everywhere, like implicit or not. And the thing which is interesting is like my function clusterize, which is what I'm going to pass it here. So the thing which is interesting is that I didn't give any type specification on what the function was about. I didn't tell it I wanted to work on irises, I want to work it on cars or whatever. I just gave it like, hey, here is a function clusterize. I'm going to give you a distance, a centroid, something which finds centroid, observations, and key. And out of this, like I didn't tell it anywhere what it was. And what it did for me was make it entirely generic. So out of my code, it's able to figure out that key has to be an integer. Like that's the number of clusters I want. That observation will be an array of A's. is could be whatever you want. It could be cars, it could be customers, it could be irises. And that, given the way I'm using these functions, like I'm using a function called distance, and that function is going to take two A's, for instance two cars, and give me back a B, which is like not even a number, but something I can compare. Which is exactly what the distance is, right? It's like I want a function which is going to get smaller if it's close and bigger if it's far. So it's like it deduced for me like exactly what the distance was. A centroid is going to be, if I give you a sequence of A's, like a group of observation, you should be able to give me one aggregate which is the representation of that whole group. So this is neat because like it completely generalized my algorithm. I can pass it whatever I want. I can pass any type, I can pass any distance I want, like it will work. So this is one thing I really, really like about the functional style here. So let me run it on the particular example we have. You're going to see, so here I'm going to, for instance, define a distance. So I'm going to give it two observations and it's going to give me a Euclidean distance and a reducer, so I'm going to just run that. Whoops, that's not what I wanted to do. And I'm not going to go much further, but like if I cluster, if I run my clusterized function here, I can plot the results, and so it's like this will potentially convince you that it actually even works. Actually, does it? It's not a great cluster. Well, it created some clusters, but my cluster are kind of crappy actually. So maybe I should use a different definition. Actually, let's do that. So it's like it looks like the distance I used was not really good. That's surprisingly bad actually. I think for the sake of time, I will not go much further. So like I was expecting better results on my clusterization. Like it looks kind of crappy, so I'm not quite sure what happened there. But so hopefully this gives you a bit of a flavor of like why a functional style might work with machine learning algorithms and what unsupervised things are. So now, as like I'm going to go to my final stretch here, so the last thing I wanted to talk about was the type providers. And so before that, it's like I talked about algorithms and all this, and that's nice. And if you go to talks on machine learning and read articles, you would get a very wrong impression of what people do when they do machine learning and data science. You would have the impression that people are just working on like extremely sexy and fancy algorithms, and they are trying to do like a ton of math, and that it's all like cutting edge, very interesting work. And really, at least that's my experience, is like that's really not what's happening. Is like most of your job is going to be plain old data janitorial work. You're going to spend like 90% of your time like getting a data set which is crap and trying to put it in a shape where you can use it. Or you're going to try to import data from somewhere, all of this. So working with the data is really, it doesn't make for great talks, but that's really a big part of the job. And it's obvious because like if you don't have data, you can't learn much. So now, why is this a problem too? Like not only is this not fun to deal with a crappy data set, but it's not easy. It's a bit of a complicated problem because you have this trade-off. It's like now you could use a dynamic language, say Python or R, or you could use a statically typed language, say Scala, say C Sharp. And if you use a dynamic language, grabbing data is not very difficult. You just try things, you hack it through, and if it works, it works, and you're a happy camper. The problem you get is like, if it works, but you have absolutely no validation on the fact that it works. And so the only way you're going to know if your model is correct is like if it doesn't explode in production. Like your validation is runtime validation. If it doesn't explode, it's probably correct. So that's good, but it's sometimes you want, if I told you like your car probably works, it might explode and then you will know it doesn't work, you might not be extremely happy about that. So the other direction is like then you don't take a dynamic language and you would take a statically typed language. In that case, you get another trade-off which is annoying. It's like now you get a compiler which is going to tell you, hey, that doesn't make sense, you're using a property which doesn't exist, this and that, so it's going to complain every inch. And to make that work, you will have to use, so it's a bit of a straitjacket, and typically you will have to use like pretty heavy artillery to get the data in your work. Because types are great, except that SQL is not your types. JSON is not your types. And so you're going to spend lots of time using tools to move types from another type system into your type system. So both of them are kind of annoying for different ways. And so this is the moment where I would say, wouldn't it be nice if a language had a solution which was kind of the best of both worlds? And so this is a to the best of my knowledge, like F-sharp is still to this day the only language which has something like type providers. I believe like iDress has something which is a bit similar. And if you have not heard about iDress, like if you think Haskell is too mainstream, like iDress is like the Haskell of Haskellers or something like that. I'm going to go into F-sharp and potentially iDress or something like this. So I'm going to show you what type operators are, because I could talk a lot about them, but like, it's probably simpler to see them in action. And so, what a type operator is, it's multiple things. Like at a high level, it's an open mechanism. You can write your type operator, everybody can, like, and the community has written like a ton of type operators. Like, what it is like it's two things. Like it's a compiler extension, so which is going to look for a particular schema. And what it will do is you would write a type operator, or you would use a type operator which is targeting a specific type of resource. And what it will do is like it will actually sniff at the schema and create magically TypeScript. So I'm going to show you a bit how this looks and why this is awesome. So here I'm going to use F-sharp data, which is one of the classic, big open source libraries with the type operators. I'm going to start with the most boring example possible. So earlier I showed you like a CSV file. Here I'm going to take another CSV file, which is probably closer to what you see typically. So this is the passenger list from the Titanic. Machine learning people do tend to have maybe a bit of a gruesome way to spend their weekends, and so the goal in this data set is like to predict, given what I knew about the passengers of the Titanic, can I predict who dies and who survived? So it's actually pretty interesting. But let's forget about that problem and just look at the data set, and this is probably similar to data sets you have seen. Here I have like headers, then I have like an ID which is an int, then I have something which is survived, and so that's 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1. So that's really a Boolean which is hiding as a 1 and a 0. I have like a passenger class, I have some strings, I have some floats, I have some missing values too, like here. So like your bread and butter CSV file, like a bit of everything, missing data, all the types possible. And I'm not going to insult you, I'm pretty sure that everybody in the room could write a parser to parse that file, it's not very difficult. But that would probably also be a waste of time. And so what you could do instead is like say, hey, it would be nice if I could use a type provider to just read it. And so here I open F-sharp data and I'm going to use the CSV provider, which is a targeting CSV file. And the only thing I have to do is like point it to the file titanic.csv. So let's do that. And I'm done. And at that point, I'm pretty set. For instance, I can do this. I can start reading the data from the file. And so here I'm reading, like if I look at first, like first is what I read from the file. And if I do first dot, so what I got here is like a fully fledged class, has like all the properties and everything. And this is not like some horrendous string dictionary. Like this is a fully statically typed thing. Like if I look at age, if I look at age here, like age is typed as a float. If I look at the cabin, that's a string. If I look at the one which is, I think, kicking in, is like if I look at survived, which was like really 0 and 1, if I remember, like it actually inferred, hey, this is 0 and 1, this is probably a bool. So it created like an entirely statically view in one line of my data set. Yes? Okay, so there are two answers to that. Like the first one is like yes, and many type operators will have different strategies because it depends a bit on the data you're looking at. But like this one, like by default, I think is looking at 100 first records, or like 1,000 to infer something reasonable. But this is completely in your control. If you want to use 1,000,000, or if you want to specify that field is a string or something, you can completely do that. It turns out that by default, like it's usually doing the right thing. Then the broader problem you're talking about is like what happens if I give it another CSV file, but like it turns out like the file is actually not following the specification, and then you hose no matter what, right? It's like then you don't have a schema, and then nothing will help you. So hold that thought. Like let me maybe go through the type operators a bit, and then because there are two parts to it. Okay, so one part is happening at. Yeah.
There is no file at compile time, like it's just a string, right?
Yes. Yeah, okay.
So this is part of what it's giving me is like right now is like it's giving me IntelliSense, or like it's giving me the ability to export the types, but it will also create a type. For instance, what I could do is I could ship that file as like the specification of the data, and that would then use that type. Let me give you an example. It's like one example would be I'm trying to think if I should give an answer. Okay, so I will not give you an answer right now. Like, how about this? Like, I'll do this after, because like otherwise I'm going to go a bit too far in the discussion. It's a good question. So this is like pretty vanilla. It's like you could say, okay, that's great. It's like type parameters, like reading CSV files. It's like it's a problem in your language, but you can start to do more funky things. For instance, like one of the F# contributors, like Thomas Petrichek, thought like, hey, it would be interesting if the World Bank has like a ton of data, which is very interesting. Like, it does things like it helps countries, it does finances. That's great, but it also has a huge data set of economic data about countries in the world. And so it would be nice if I could actually access that data in an easy fashion. And so he wrote a type parameter to the World Bank. And so what this is doing is like, this is where I'm hoping I'm still connected on the internet, but like this is going to actually, I'm going to do World Bank dot. And so if I do this, this is actually going to look at the World Bank live over the wire and tell me what I have available. So for instance, I see that I have countries dot, and now this is going to show me it's pinging the website over the wire and creating the types. And so this is showing me now like all the countries which the World Bank has data about. So let's take a random person. Let's take you, like what's the last foreign country? Yeah, you. Like, what's the last foreign country you visited?
Iran.
Good. So I forgot what the capital of Iran was. So I'm going to go to Iran. IR, and I can even search for this. That's probably Iran Islamic Republic. And now I'm going to look at what do I have. I have data here, I have maybe the capital city. And so this is all happening over the wire, just to be clear, like no trickery. And so if I do that, it's going to ping it, and it's telling me back, hey, like the World Bank tells me that today the capital of Iran is Tehran. Like, which I think is correct. I could even do a bit more. So this is it happens like I actually had to play with the files from the World Bank in the past, and you really don't want that. But the data is great, but it's just not fun. But like this is where people coming from statistics start to cry, because I could also do this. I could do indicators, and I could ask, hey, about Iran, what indicators do I have available? And so I could do this, and now this is going to show me like what I have available from the World Bank against, again, coming over the wire. So you can't quite see, I think, the scroll bar, but like it's huge. Like I think I'm getting like 2,000 indicators. So I could do something like say I'm typing J, like in J I would get like the currency composition of PPG debt or the scientific and technical journal articles. Like it's just amazing the data you have right there. And I can just explore it like that over the wire. For instance, I could do a simple one, like indicators, let's say population. I have plenty of populations actually. Total. And let's say I'm going to ask for the population in 2000. And this should go over there, and like, so it looks like it's worth like 65 million, is that right? Yeah, so it's like that sounds also like plausible. So that's a completely different usage. Like we had one case which was a local file in a machine, but you could be very creative with what you can do. Like I could ping a web service and get types just by inspecting the result. Another thing I could do, so far, I'm going to pass this. What I showed was the use case is really like looking at data sources, and the community has written pretty much type parameters for everything. You have a type parameter for XML, for JSON, for like CSV. There is one specifically for SQL Server by a guy in the San Francisco area, which is awesome. There is one for like every flavor of SQL. There is one for like pretty much. There is one for HTML scraping. Like so. Anytime, so it's kind of difficult to find ways to write a type parameter today, because most of the low-hanging fruits have been done. But people still go crazy. Like there is a guy who is writing, for instance, a type parameter which is write your own adventure. Like where every time you dot, it's actually creating an adventure. If things like that, people just go like crazy with what you can do with this. So, anyways, like this is a bit focused on data, but like you could go a bit crazier, because really what the type parameter is doing is like it's looking at something which has a schema and inferring types and giving them to me for consumption. So that works great for data.
There is another case or another thing which also has a structure, a schema, and which I would like to use, and that could be another language. And so there is a guy who thought like, hey, like, why not write a typewriter to another language? And so that's the example I'm going to show now. And the example is like a typewriter to R. So if you, the joke on R goes like, it's a language written by statisticians for statisticians. So the for statisticians part is like, if you're looking for a free statistical library for pretty much anything, R has a package for everything under the sun, and it's absolutely awesome. The by statistician is a bit less pleasant because it's a language written by statistician, and so as a language, it's not the most pleasant thing to use. But as an F-sharp person, I would love to be able to use the packages R offers. And so one guy wrote a typewriter to R, and so this is what I'm going to show here. And so like, I have R installed on my machine, right? So it's like it's not inventing R out of thin air. But now, like, the first thing he's going to do is, like, for instance, I can see like every package I have on my machine. Like, I can start exploring like, the things I have, and I can literally start using R from within the context of my F-sharp scripting. For instance, I can do things like I'm going to create an array of random numbers, so that's completely an F-sharp thing, and I can say, hey, take this, send it to R, if I do R dot, I'm going to see what functions I have available. So R dot is going, this is everything I can pull from R. So now I can say, like, take this, pass it to a log, and plot it. It's not the most compelling example, but this is showing the point, which is that now I can consume everything from R within F-sharp, and I can still use F-sharp, which is a...
Is it spawning the little process in which it's running R, or how
is it? It's talking to R.
But would you be able to run this in production, or is this just...
In general, I would probably not advise running R in production, but... yeah, you could, it's feasible. People do it because, like, it turns out that actually R has phenomenal visualization and, like, packages which are just great. It's just, so I would say it's a last resort. Like, if you can avoid it, it's probably my recommendation. And so now the thing which is nice is I can use R, and so now there are people who tell me, yeah, that's great, but I'm really getting a crappy experience compared to RStudio because I could use RStudio with all the tools for R. Except that the thing which is nice is I can use R, but I can also use all my other typewriters. For instance, I could do something like, hey, talk to the World Bank and grab data from the World Bank over the wire and like create a chart for me showing the GDP of China over 10 years. That's nice. And that's the type of scenario which is pretty difficult to do in many. I don't think like other languages have exactly the same ability to glue things that way. I could do things like, let me see. I'm going to create a sample here, which is talk to the World Bank, give me every country which was more than 750 million people, grab the growth, grab the pollution, grab the youth, so that's using the World Bank. And now I'm going to put it into a data frame, and I can plot it. So this is neat because I can now do things like this, like I can start exploring data using all the packages I have in R, and I can do even nicer things. So I'm going to finish with one where I'm going to take like every country in the world, grab the population in 2010 and 2000, put it in a data frame and send it in R and do me a map. Why not? That's so this is doing things, and this is again pretty neat, right? Because like, I mean, I think this is pretty awesome. So it's like, if you think about what happened here, is like I said, hey, go to the World Bank, make calls over the wire, grab me every country, pull the population in 2000 and 2010, bring that back into F-sharp, take it from F-sharp, send it to R to produce a plot. So the map is maybe not super spectacular because, hey, yeah, there are lots of people in certain countries, like not many people in Greenland, but the whole integration is pretty phenomenal. So I hope that gives you a bit of a sense for what typewriters are. And I think it's a good time for me to close. So my conclusion is like, if you're on .NET, I think F-sharp is really, really the language you want to look at. One is like the functional style works in general very well with machine learning. So that's true if you use Scala, Haskell, Clojure, like I just think it's a fit. The REPL, the interactive experience is important, and that's specifically for F-sharp compared to C-sharp because like we have in F-sharp like a scripting environment built in. You can use it like everywhere in .NET, like not only, it's not like I have to use this language and I cannot use it with anything else, it will fit with your whole .NET code base. And the type four writers are just like, for me, they're just like awesome. Like it's like essentially, if you think back about what I said, is like I'm getting the same ease of use, I'm getting all the benefits of types. I get discoverability, I get like safety, I will not make mistakes on typing a property and discover at runtime that there was a typo, but it's dead easy to grab the data out of pretty much anywhere. So that's an amazing thing. Things I left out, I didn't talk, there is more to F-sharp and to the topic, so I wanted to do it, but it was just not reasonable in time, but like one of the things which is awesome in the functional space and machine learning is Spark, which is more a Scala thing, and so there is something equivalent on the F-sharp side, which is called Embrace, which allows you to take code from your script. So to your point, the gentleman over there was saying, hey, like you're loading everything in a tiny machine. I'm not going to run like terabytes of data on this thing, but I still want scripts. And so what Embrace gives me is I can write a script, but I can run it against a cluster of like arbitrary number of machines, parallelizing my job and getting the answer back. That's pretty awesome. And that's kind of what Spark does on the Scala side. FSLab is one place you might want to look at for a collection of libraries together. Does anybody know what Autodef is? No, so I won't. So I'll mention it because like, for some people it matters. It's actually pretty awesome. Autodef is the idea is like you can write code which is going to automatically produce differentiation of your functions. So if you have done a gradient descent, which is like a core element of machine learning, it's extremely useful to be able to produce a derivative or a Hessian or stuff like that. And DiffSharp is phenomenal. You give it a function in F-sharp and it will produce the actual differential. Like it does, doing a gradient descent is a two-liner. Like it's really amazing. And you have IPython integration if you like IPython and that type of stuff. If you want to learn more about F-sharp, one place to go is fsharp.org, which is the F-sharp foundation. That's where you go if you want to know how to set it up on Linux. That's where you want to go if you want to know how to use it for gaming, to do whatever you want. Like it's the one right entry point. Otherwise, there is a great meetup group in the Bay Area, and so just look on meetup for F-sharp, you'll find it. There is actually one in San Francisco and one in South Bay. South Bay has been a bit inactive, but we are hoping to restart it. And if you want to get in touch with the community, so I love the language as a language, but the other reason I really love F-sharp is the community is phenomenal. It's like people are just responsive, like if you have a problem, they will give you answers, they are just very friendly, and you will find them a lot on Twitter, and the hashtag, the magical hashtag is F-sharp fully spelled out. So that's not F-sharp like that, but F-sharp fully. So like that's how you get in touch with us F-sharp people. Shameless plug, I have a book out, it's completely awesome. You should buy it or not. If you want to know more, I'll tell more. And otherwise, if you want to ping me anything, like this is my email, this is my Twitter handle, and this is what I got in store. So thank you. So now might be a good time for, so what time is it?
8:42.
So, how long, I guess it's like, let's see how many questions we got. So it's like, who has questions? So, okay, so it looks like four people, so we might be able to fit it in a reasonable time. I will let you fight, and let's go.
So if one is shopping for a programming environment for implementing machine learning, applying it to a particular programming domain, what would be the reason for picking F-sharp over, say, R?
Okay. That's actually a great question, and it's a bit of a tricky one. I'll try to give a slightly different answer. I'll answer a slightly different question. Like, if my nephew or my niece came to me today and said, hey, I want to do machine learning, what's the first thing I should learn? I would not tell my nephew or niece to learn F-sharp as the first thing to learn. Because like right now, if you look at where the traction is, like I think Python has a... So R has a humongous set of packages and a very strong community. Python is a bit the same way, except that it's probably more of a same language. They are richer and they have a longer history. So it's probably easier to find people in the specific topic of machine learning. If I think of it, so with that caveat, is like I would still, I mean, I'm using F-sharp pretty much all the time and for that type of topic. So the one place where like my answer would be different is like, if your company is using .NET, I would say like that would be a very smart move. Because now you're getting lots of benefits out of this. Because you get something which is going to interrupt like, completely smoothly with the rest of your production code. You can do it for exploration. You can give it,
you need a bit of training probably, but a data scientist can pick up F-sharp and work on F-sharp code and give it to production people. Like one case I keep coming, I keep seeing everywhere is like teams where you have like one dude who's the data guy and who's writing MATLAB code or whatever he does. So he does the algorithm, then dumps it on the desk of a C-sharp guy and say, hey, that's my code. And now like somebody has to translate it. Either you run MATLAB in production, which is not fun, or you convert it, which is not a good idea either. So that's and that happens in lots of places. That you have that not even in machine learning, but you have that in finance, you have that in everywhere where you have a bit of numeric code. And with F-sharp, what you can achieve if you want is like if your mainline application is running in .NET, you could actually have like a seamless integration between your data team or your data science and machine learning team and IT team. And otherwise, I think there are like benefits. Like in general, I think that applies to Scala and other things. I think functional is a bit of a jump. I would assume that Python is probably easier to pick up because, in a way, like Python is like English. Like everybody speaks it poorly, but everybody speaks it. Like everybody can read Python code. I read Python code, and I don't really write that much, but I pick it up. But the functional code probably going to take you a bit more of a stretch, so it's a bit of an investment. But at the same time, I think this is where things are headed. Because Python is great now, but like functional code is much easier to parallelize. I didn't even talk about this. Like, lots of reasons. There is a reason why every single language today is starting to have lambdas. It's like me too, I have lambdas. Even C++ has lambdas. So, does this answer your question? Who else had questions? Can you, machine learning from, sorry, for what?
So one of your slides, you mentioned three different packages for doing machine learning.
Yes.
One was the or something, and where did those come from?
All of the ones I showed were, everything I showed actually was open source libraries.
Open source.
Yep. So the first one, accord.net, it's kind of shocking actually. The guy has been working on this library for 6 or 7 years, and it's amazingly good. And it's just like very few people know about it. Like, but it's finally starting to get visibility. But that library is just like it's unbelievable that one guy wrote it. And now he gets like more contributors. But it's been around for a while. Math.net is a very well maintained algebra library. F-sharp data, the type operator one, is a completely open source, like maintained by the community. And what was the other one I showed? I think that's it. Yep. No, but with some caveats. So I don't want to say like, hey, it works great on Linux exactly the same way. I would say like probably Windows is the place where it runs the best, but like it, everything I showed today will run on Linux. The one I had doubt a couple of months ago, but I hold it from a good source that it works, is the R-type operator was the one where there was a bit of a doubt because it was a bit of a complicated beast. Otherwise, like in general, like if you go to GitHub and look at the open source libraries on F-sharp, it's actually fairly different from the mainstream .NET ecosystem in general. It's like this is one place where I met like plenty of people who are actually not working on Windows. Whereas like on C-sharp, I know only people who know Windows. And the most of the libraries you will see actually have builds which run on both and which are tested on both platforms. Like it's a genuine. It's not like we should also test it on mono. It's like typically that's part of the project. Yep?
You mentioned Spark. How far is the whole F-sharp ecosystem?
Compared to Spark?
Yeah, multiple cluster, large cluster, distributed world.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so Embrace is okay, so the answer is like, I think the difference is like Embrace came a bit later to the game. So the I have been using it productively on things, but it's like how to put it? The foundations are really good. So what it offers, for instance, is like you have a very good low-level constructs for parallelism. You have like awesome constructs for streaming data, like and pipelines and stuff like that. Like it's really amazing. The thing which is weaker is like you don't have the same depth of the libraries ecosystem. Like you don't have that much high-level constructs yet. That's the big difference. The nuts and bolts are there, but like the higher level in the stack is less there.
There's now the F-sharp Spark library. I saw it.
Interesting.
I don't know anything about it, but
Yeah, exactly. I haven't touched it either. But like the low-level construct. I even talked with the guy. So I think the low-level constructs are fairly close. It's just like less history and so less high-level tool. Yep.
Coming back to your first example with the digit recognizer.
Yep.
If you wanted to improve the accuracy of that model, so you showed us that it had 90% of accuracy
yep.
and 500 entries and we're part of the training set. And so where would you start? Would you look at basically, is it about tweaking parameters and using the same algorithm? Is it about using a different algorithm? Is it about modeling the data in a different way?
All about
the flow?
Kind of all of the above. It's like, I'll take a step back also from your question. There are two ways you could improve the model. The model I have is like pretty slow right now, and one would be like, hey, it's a great model, but it takes half an hour and it needs to run in production fast. That's a completely different direction, right? But like the on improving the part of it is a there's a great book which came out. I wish no the it's part of it is a it's honestly a bit of a, an art form, like it's a lot of it is like trial and error, and like and then is like you develop experience. So it's like the things you could do is like one of them is like. It's really experimental too. It's like because in the end, it's like you don't know if it will work. Like you never have guarantees. Like which is kind of tricky too. Because like if my boss comes and tells me, hey, like here is the data. When can you give me a model? If I'm lucky, I could have a fantastic model in 5 minutes. And if I'm unlucky, I could have like a crap model for 6 months. It's like you just don't know what will work. That being said, is like so the things you can do is one is like you can use different algorithms and just see what works. That's one side. The second side is like a big part of it, at least I really believe in like feature modeling, which is like being smart about the features you use. And if you just dump data into a black box algorithm, you're probably going to get, you might get like reasonable results, but you won't get awesome results. Like you start to understand more your data and extract features which make more sense. So a lot of it for me is like trying to figure out, playing with the data itself, the model. But I don't have like, I would make a ton of money if I had the trick with a kid. More questions? Then, thank you very much. I had fun, so have a good evening, and thanks for coming.